since I'm a nerd, so I'm talking about science a little bit anyway. So this picture here is beautiful, as you can actually see. This is a real picture that was rendered, it was actually rendered from a real picture of, from electron microscope. This is a picture of the complex that control the movement of the cell. So let's see, if you actually take a droplet of water, just a drop of water, this one actually was taken from a canal next to Suan Chit Lada in Bangkok. Just one droplet and magnify it by a little bit, you will see an amazing creature in the water. Look at this guy. His name is Lacrimalia olor. He is actually very beautiful and amazing. But imagine when you're actually jogging, you know, next to the canal and you see the fountain just go like, you don't want to actually get hit by the water, right? So anyway, science is beautiful. It's amazing. And if you keep zooming in and zooming in, look at this. This is a picture of a virus, dengue virus, that caused a severe disease. And it's actually beautiful. This 3D rendition was actually reconstructed from a real data from electron microscope as well. And also this one here is HIV capsid, right, that caused AIDS. I think none of us want to have it, right? This one is a picture of a protein that forms a capsid of also another virus that infects shrimp, and it's caused a damage in aquaculture industry quite dramatically. And you can see the science is beautiful. It's amazing. So today, since we are in a beautiful city of Chiang Mai, I'm going to share with you how can I become mesmerized by the beauty of a small things like this. So actually, back when the story began back when I was a kid. Back then, I was actually a bad kid. When I was in high school, I was so passionate in art and design. And every time my teacher turned their back at us and write on the blackboard, I was sitting next to the window, I design, and I'm making something. I make a paper airplane. And we actually bet with our friend, whose airplane gonna go the farthest? When the teacher turned back, we threw the airplane out. And most of the time, my airplane just U-turn and go to the room below, which is an unfortunate. So I always have to treat him with the meal. But anyway, that was because I didn't find my passion. And what actually, at that time, I was trying to think what I want to be. And since I hate needle and I hate blood, when I see needle, I get dizzy. So I kind of believe for a long period of time that I'm destined to become an engineer. And one day I met my high school counselor and he told me, you know, you don't have to take biology because you don't have to use it in an engineering program. And so I was very excited. I was lazy. I was excited. I go back to home and I told my mom, Mom, I don't want to take biology class. It will be useless for me in an engineering school. And my mom looked at me and like, what are you talking about? And she was telling me, Hoi, you haven't taken this class at all. How can you know you won't like it? Turns out biology is what I did best in my school. And I start to like it more and more. And at some point, my goal in life has changed. Now I'm a hardcore biologist, right? As you can actually see, it's quite hardcore, right? So, or you can call it nerd. But anyway, I'm a hardcore biologist. But as a note, I no longer throw paper airplane out of my window because now my room is air conditioned. Anyway, I move on a little bit. So as a note for younger generation as well, so if you actually have never tried something, try it. Maybe you might actually find something like me. I found my talent, my hidden talent, that I will never have found if I didn't try it. So opens up and try a new thing and try it. So then I pursue in science. So when I was in a PhD program, I was actually trying to solve a structure of a protein called BT toxin. So this is the structure of the protein that I solve. It's actually look quite cool, isn't it? But it doesn't really tell you much. but it tells a lot of things about the protein for a scientist. And if you look at this picture here, it shows that how the toxin actually forms a structure when it's actually kills the insect cells. So this toxin has been used quite a lot in the industry, in agriculture industry, particularly to actually control the insect pests and disease transmission vector. So not only is beautiful, it gives us a lot of interesting information that we can actually use for improving our society as well. And the next thing I was actually work on was, back then I moved to Berkeley, and at Berkeley I have to find something that is a little bit more interesting. So I was looking at this guy, actually the video was just stopped, but anyway, it's fine. You probably know this guy, right? What are they? They're sperm. And every time and you can actually see that they actually move in a very unique fashion. They're turning their head around and around without getting dizzy, right? So it is amazing. And I was actually very excited about it. I want to know how the sperm move. I was looking at the complex just right next to the head where it's controlled the bend initiation of the sperm. Every time I give a talk about this work, people always look at me in a very strange way. And, you know, the most frequent question I got was not very scientific. They asked me, whose sperm are they? Right? But don't worry, it is not mine. Right? It's actually from a happy cow in California, actually a happy bull in California. Right? Okay, so this is a 3D rendition that I got of the sperm connecting piece. This was actually featured as a cover page of a journal, Biology of Reproduction, and it was including in a textbook recently. It is actually quite impressive how the structure, this complex is actually driving the sperm motility, right? And it was a big deal for a scientist to get on a cover page, so my friend always honored me by actually introducing me affectionately to all the girls I meet in a party, that he is extremely smart. He is a sperm expert. And we thought it was cool. I was in San Francisco, and the girl always looked at me in a very strange way, but we didn't realize that thinking about it again is not, indeed, not very cool, isn't it? Anyway, apart from doing science, I was also still love art and design. I practice and I experiment with different way of creative writing and art and poetry. Indeed, I was actually writing for a scientific magazine to try to actually make the science more interesting for the public. So a lot of people actually have been asking me, how can I do well on both art, poetry, and science? Because they seem to be using different set of skills. They seem to use different part of the brain. And so when people ask me that, I look at them and I didn't know what to answer. But for me, to be honest with you, the real answer for me is that the only connection between all these disciplines, art, science, and poetry, is love. I really love what I do, and I savor every moment I'm doing it. And that is something to tell you, is that if you actually love what you do, and you believe that you can do it, just go for it, and you'll be able to do it without any problem. Be confident and be passionate. So, in fact, I was actually thinking about quitting, you know, science to do art for a really long period of time. But since it's actually so beautiful, I can't do it, right? Anyway, it is actually a very interesting art piece. Maybe Hussein might to collect some, but we don't really know, right? Anyway, as a matter of fact, science, art, poetry, and everything now, they are merging together into one big disciplinary. It's not separated anymore. But the main problem is our curriculum, the educational curriculum that we have right now, is largely fragmented. The students in the science and math program in high school have basically paying no attention or little attention to art and other disciplines. But students in the art and language program actually have no clue about science. And that fragmented curriculum has been actually damaging to our society. Right now, everything is merging together. Everything is merging together into one big multidisciplinary. We need somebody to actually help in terms of, you know, joining force together between different multidisciplinary people to put effort and help educate people in public so that they are not being dragged by the superstition and the crown. There's no way we can create successful scientific knowledge-based scientific society if we are still working separately. So anyway, we are who we are, and it doesn't really matter. The only thing that matters is we are who we are. It doesn't matter what profession we have, and if we are just what we believe we are, we can do everything we want if we want to keep trying it. And so you can view me as an artist in a lab coat, or you can view me as a crazy scientist who is mesmerized by the art. But I am here because I love what I do, and I would like to share it with you. So without creativity and with our cooperation, we can potentially help each other and make a better society where we have a more scientific awareness, right? Thank you.